Business Council special meeting for this date. And so at this time, I'm going to call the meeting to order, and we will have our invocation at this time. And want to welcome our new vice president to the Business Council, Daryl Wildcat. And so he's with us, and he's the bright, shiny one here to my right. But let's have our invocation, and Daryl, I'm going to ask you if you would say our blessing this morning, the council meeting.
Lord, dears, thank you for the blessing you bestowed upon us. Heavenly Father, be with us this day and every day, Heavenly Father. Thank you for this beautiful day you've given us, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, give us the wisdom and the courage to move forward, Heavenly Father, for the betterment of our people, Heavenly Father. Guide us, Heavenly Father, in our decisions, Heavenly Father. Help us move forward as a nation, Heavenly Father. I ask all this in Jesus' name, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. This time we'll have roll call, please. Here.
Carol Walkett.
Here.
Amy Riddleston. Here. Angela Thompson.
Here.
Sammy Anson.
Here.
Donna here.
Here.
Adrian Spotted Horseshoe.
Here.
And Anna Teeter.
Here.
Donna's really here. And we do have a quorum. We'll declare a quorum this morning. Item number 3 is approval of the agenda. And I think the agendas you have before you, Council, there is one addition, and that is the Pawnee Nation College President Report, and that will be item number 10. It will be after the Pawnee Tribal Development Corporation Report. So we're adding the Pawnee Nation College President Report. We have our ED and our AG. They are on travel. They're coming back from Dallas. They had a fracking summit meeting that they're attending with the EPA. And so Don Mason asked that item number 7, the approval of Resolution 1629, museum bylaws, would be tabled today and brought back at the next council meeting. So we will table the museum bylaws. Are there any other additions or changes to the agenda? Just a second, we're checking. We're tabling the museum bylaws, item number 7, and we'll move it to the next council meeting. And we added the Pawnee Nation College President Report after the TDC report. Okay. Okay, if there's no other changes, we can, yes? Oh. Okay, yes. What we have is we have through Budget Committee recommendations. We have an additional 5 more that we are adding. So it would be to the Budget Committee recommendations, we are adding G, H, I, J, and K, 5 more items. To item number 6, Budget Committee recommendations. Okay, Yeah. Okay, just the five. Just the five are being added to the agenda. All right, if there's no other changes, we can have a motion to accept the agenda with changes. We have a motion. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay, we have a second by Sammy. Call for the vote, please.
Darryl Wildcat?
Yes.
Jamie Littleson?
Yes.
Angela Thompson?
Yes.
Sammy Adson?
Yes.
Donna Hare?
Yes.
Adrian Spotted Horseshoe?
Yes.
Diana Keto?
Yes.
All right. The agenda is set. So now we go to item number four, and that's the approval of the minutes, Pawnee Business Council minutes, meeting minutes, March 14th, 2016. We can entertain a motion to approve.
I'll make the motion to approve.
The motion is made. Is there a second?
Cynthia, did you still need the line 410 and 416? Did you still need that? Well, I don't have it. And that is the motion made to come out of executive session. Session, motion made to come out and seconded and to adjourn. Motion and seconded, and I didn't write that down.
Second.
I'll second the minutes. Is that what you're looking for?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
I have a question.
Sure.
What do we do in the instance when we don't have the to fill in these blanks?
I have it right.
Yeah, it's written down. We don't think we can fill it out.
Go into executive session. I made the motion. Angela seconded it. And I'm out. I made the motion. I made the motion and Angela seconded.
Call for the question.
Yeah, call for the question. I'm sorry. I've got computer problems.
Garawaka.
You can just abstain.
Amy Littleson, abstain. Angela Thompson?
Yes.
Sammy Adson?
Yes.
Donna Hare?
Yes.
Aaron Spotted Horse Chief?
Yes.
Leanna Keir?
Yes.
Okay, the minutes for March 14, 2016 are passed. And now we'll move on to the Pawnee Business Council meeting minutes, March 24, 2016. Entertain a motion.
I make a motion.
Motion is made. Is there a second?
I'll second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions? Call for the vote.
Daryl Walcott. Okay. Amy Littleson. Yes. Angela Thompson.
Abstain.
Sammy Adson.
Yes.
Donna Hare.
Yes.
Adrian Spotted Horse Chief.
Yes.
Leanna Keir.
Yes.
All right. That passes. And so we'll move on to item number five, the President's Council report. And my report is short. We've had, as I know all of you are aware, we've had a lot of funerals. And so a lot of the meetings I was to attend were canceled. I did attend the fracking community meeting that we had here. That was put on by the staff, the AG, ED, Bunky Echopop, Monty Matlock, and had a good turnout, good attendance. Things were presented to the people, and maybe some of the others would like to comment more on that because we were all here. So that was good. It was good to give information to the people and to share that with them. The only other meeting that I attended was the Oklahoma Indian Chamber of Commerce meeting, which was held in Stillwater, and they'd been asking for an attendance there. So since it was just real close, so I went over there, attended it, and then what it is just they try to bring in business leaders and try to connect with the tribal governments and just have an interaction and basically information. They had the lady there from the radio station who sells advertisement there in Stillwater, and so met her. She would really like to get involved with any of our community efforts and anything community related that she could put on the air, you know, for free. And so have that information from her. And then I think the Iowas were there and the Sac and Foxes were there. And those were the only two that, tribes that were there. And this has been ongoing for a long time. And so it was good to meet new folks and to share with them. And they'd just like to have a more involvement with the tribe. And so... that's something that any of our departments would like to be a part of. It would be a good thing. And they meet monthly there in Stillwater. And so that was the Oklahoma Indian Chamber of Commerce. And those were the only meetings that I attended. Oh, other than the health board meeting, which was conducted yesterday here at the service unit. And really wasn't a regular type meeting. It was the meeting, the annual meeting that they have where they bring in all the doctors. So Dr. Sanders was there representing the service unit. They had the other doctors from the Tonkawas up there, the Osages, and even the Iowas were there. And it was mainly for them, administrative part, doctor part, how to better do medicine, how to better interact with the patients and things. And so I attended that, that's an annual thing that the clinic does, that the service unit does, I mean. And so that was yesterday. And so that's my report. Like I said, had a lot of deaths, so we've been busy doing that. So at this time, we'll move on to item number 6, the council committee reports. And what we'll do with the council committee reports, and let's go ahead and combine your committee reports and travel reports as a committee. So, and next time we'll just have them together, Cindy, committee reports and the travel reports. That way we won't have to go through twice. So we'll start with Donna Hare. Any reports that you have?
I don't have any committee reports. We haven't met since the last council meeting on the two committees I serve on, where there's a lot of activity, which is the HR, where we're developing policy. We've had any meetings there, and also on enrollment, but we have a meeting coming up next week on enrollment, or in 2 weeks, and then we haven't, I didn't attend a property meeting either. So, going on to the travel, I attended the, let me pull this up. I attended the Indigenous Athletic Commission Summit in Oklahoma City, and it was a good conference. It was held at the airport, the embassy by what is it called, Oklahoma City Embassy, Airport Embassy Hotel, and it was a pleasant surprise to find out that it was owned by the Mille Lacs tribe of up north. And that they actually own that facility. So when we went, my initial reaction was going to be, why wasn't this held at a tribal facility? So the president was there from the Mille Lacs, and she got up and announced that they bought that hotel 2 years ago. And it's really nice. The meeting was informational. I mean, it provided a lot of good information, and the tribes that are involved in the athletic commissions are really committed. And I would like for the Pawnee Nation to move forward in looking at establishing that, because I think that the tribes that do make a lot of money. The Wichita, Terry Parton, president of the Wichitas, were there, and she was talking about how they had a fighter who was Wichita, and it just brought the whole community together, you know, to support their tribal member. And they just talked about what, you know, how it provides entertainment, and then I've heard from other sources that it provides a lot of monetary benefits to the tribes that have them. The other meeting that I attended was earlier this week, and it was preparing for the seventh generation, and it was a really good conference. Walter Echohawk opened up the meeting, and he gave an excellent historical account of Indian nations, Native nations, and why the health, you know, that we're facing the health problems that we are today. And it was a lot of the people in the audience were really impressed with his presentation. But they had a lot of several breakout sessions, and it was, they had some sessions on incorporating your culture for your youth, and setting up the framework on that. And they also had the Intertribal Agricultural Council ongoing vegetable presentation and developing working models on that. And then yesterday they had a really good presentation, and it was by Dr. Dolores Bigfoot, and it was on a lot of it was on historic trauma and the health issues, you know, with within Indian country. But I'm working on my written report, and I'll share that with everybody. But it was a good conference, and I was glad to see Adrian and Fahmy in attendance, and Leanna. And so there were four of us there, and so I'm hoping that we can really come back and incorporate some of the information, you know, that we learned and bring it forward, you know, to the council.
Any questions for Donna? All right, we'll move on to Leanna.
Can you come back to me, young guy? I was busy.
All right, well, we'll move on to Angela.
Okay, we had two budget committee meetings this month in preparation for this meeting. We had one on April 7th and one on April 14th. The majority of the approvals are on the agenda today, so I'm not going to go into those in detail. Also, one major thing is that the 2017 budget call was issued this week, and so we're right on track in getting the 2017 budgets started and getting approved before the August 15th deadline to council. So we'll be on right on track, and it'll give the budget committee a lot more time for review and bringing those things forward, so it won't be such in a rush. So I'm very pleased for that. So thank you to the staff that's involved, Muriel, the executive office, planning, anybody else who's finance, of course, you know, involved in that. We appreciate your work on that. On the yesterday's meeting, it was supposed to be a two-day or a two-agenda meeting. It ended up to be about 10, but that's okay. And like I said, majority of those are on here. We did have a couple of updates. The Pawnee, the 2015 allocation and 2016 allocation for the Salazar dollars was issued. The check was cut to the schools for the language program, so that's taken care of and off our agenda. The other thing is the Pawnee Public Schools, the middle school donation, that has been completed. We received all the documentation needed to make that payment to the schools. Let's see. And I'm going to defer the Enhancing Research Success Abroad Symposium to Councilman Spotted Horse Chief. Do you want to do that now, or do you want to wait to your report? Okay, you can do it when you get to your report. No, I can finish. That's all I have. Everything else is on the agenda, and I'll go into detail on that. So thank you.
Okay. Any questions for Angela?
Oh, I did have a travel.
Okay.
Because I did attend TBIC in March in D.C., and I did the presentation for the Southern Plains region to all of the whole TBIC council and with the assistant secretary. And TBIC is the Tribal Interior Budget Council. There's two representatives for the Southern Plains region. I serve with Randall Thomas. He's with the Alabama Coushatta Tribe, and during this meeting, it was a presentation on the 2018 presidential budget. We had to have meetings with the Southern Plains region and identifying what our priorities were and our unmet need, and going forward to present it to the assistant secretary to develop his budget for the president's budget. So some of the issues that are facing the Southern Plains, I don't just represent the Pawnee tribe on this council, I represent the whole region. So in taking our things forward, I also take the region's priorities and unmet needs forward as well. The main topics I did present on that were specific to Southern Plains as well as the Pawnee Nation was Indian child welfare. I brought out about that we don't have enough funding for our case management, and some of these issues like the Baby Veronica case and the Choctaw case and out recently is if we had the money to provide in the state courts and bring those cases back to tribal court and had the money to adequately case manage those programs, we might not have issues like baby Veronica and baby, I think, Alexandria out in Utah, is it? The Choctaw, the recent case. And so I brought that forward because we don't, one thing that here we don't have is enough money to support our Indian Child Welfare Program. And a lot of the tribes in nationally don't have enough money to support that program. And so when there is, when our kids are placed in state custody, we cannot go and intervene and bring that child and make ICWA work for us because it's so limited funding. The other issue was the fracking. I brought that about, that there's not enough money that the BIA or Department of Interior is providing even the Pawnee agency to monitor and the fracking actions or modern oil and gas activities. And they, and these huge oil companies know that, that the BIA cannot monitor them, so they're violating, and it's affecting not our current tribal members' property and our land and our environment, but our future generations. So I took that message forward as well. So it was a good meeting. It was a good, I thought it, the presentation went well. So we'll just keep going and hopefully, you know, make some forward movement. Thank you.
Any questions?
All right.
Turn it over to our VP. You got any reports?
I'm new to the council here, so that's all I got to report.
Well, that's good. That's a good report there. Next meeting, though. All right, he'll be ready. Mamie.
Say good morning to everyone. Let's see, I attended the budget meeting on the 7th. I lost my calendar book somewhere. I have everything written down on my calendar, my meetings I attend, and I don't know where it's at. So nevertheless, I attended that meeting, and then on last Friday, I attended the Gathering of Voices 2016 Gathering of Voices. It was the 2016 Gathering of Voices. It was addressing sexual assault in the Indian country. It's held every year in the state capitol building. And the Pawnee Nation is always represented there. Chelsea Baldwin, she always goes over and she has a table set up. And she has a lot to do. It's the Alliance Against Violence, I believe is what it's called. They sponsor it every year. And she got in touch with me, and she asked me if I would come down there, and I would do the opening prayer for that organization and for that meeting. And so I've been down there several times before, so I told her I'd be honored to go down there. And she asked if I could bring the flag down to represent the Pawnee Nation. So I picked up the tribal flag from Bruce, and I headed down there. And it's growing, that, and it's really neat because it's right there in the middle of the state capitol. And, of course, you have to go through all the red tape and all like that, and even to get in the building. But the turnout was really great. The guest speaker this year was a lady called Sarah Deer. And then they also did presentations from all the tribal leaders. They had several tribal leaders, tribal chair people that were there, and just other tribal leaders. Chairman of the Ponca Nation was there, Mr. Howe, and then the chairman of the Kaw Nation, she was there. Congress, I believe they call him Congressman of the Osage Nation, Otto Hamilton, he was there. And they all got up and they spoke about, you know, the violence in their communities and things that they're doing to change it and to make a difference. And so it was a really nice turnout, and I enjoyed the speakers that they had came over, and even one of the, I believe she's a House representative, and she looks Gati, but she's Indian. She was Indian, you know, she claimed Choctaw. And so, but she really, man, she got up and she really gave a really, really, really inspirational speech, you know. And so I really enjoyed her, and she was real down to earth, and she was real funny. She even with such a topic that, you know, addressing sexual assault in Indian country, you know, then still yet she was able to make us laugh, but she was just really really outgoing, and she really spoke well, and she made us all laugh, and she just made us feel good just by her presence. And then even being in the high office that she was there in the state capitol, she really was down to earth, and I really liked that about her. And then there's a, I believe he's called Mr. Ford Killer. He was also a representative that came and spoke to us, and so I was real glad that because we're right there, then it gave those people the opportunity to come and see what we're doing, see what we're about, see what's going on. And so I enjoyed the time over there. And then I attended the Seventh Generation Conference held in Tulsa this past week. And I was real glad to see that Pawnees were well represented, just like what Donna was saying, with Bunky being the opening speaker. And then also Dana Beard from our program here, she was one of the presenters over there. And she did a presentation. So I was real glad about that we were represented over there. But one of the breakout sessions that really stood out in my mind was an organization called I Am Indian. And it was, I think, brought up by the Comanche Nation, I believe it was. And they just, you know, they're doing wonders with their kids. And it's stands for the Nations Against Drug Use. But it's just really, and it was really awesome to see. They even did their own videos, the kids did, and they had just list of things where they're just really getting things going with their youth. They're really promoting them to stay away from drugs and alcohol, and they're using their culture in order to get them interested in other activities so that they stay away from drug and alcohol. And they're going back to the basics of cultural teaching. You know, I guess we were oral people at one time. You know, you talk to your kids, you tell them this and that. And then somewhere it began to skip a generation where we don't do those things anymore. That's why we have our kids in trouble and things like that. All these different things that come up. So they're like bringing back their oral tradition where they're sitting down, they're speaking with their kids, they're telling them, they're teaching them, they're bringing their elders in to talk to them, you know, to tell them about, hey, this is how we're supposed to be as Native people, this is how we're supposed to be, this is how our grandparents were. And so it's working. They have a large group, you know, and about culture, you know, they're teaching them, they want to dance and make their outfits and go and dance, you know, you want to sing, then they have singing session. They even had a video where they taught them all to put up a teepee. And so they videoed themselves. It was girls and boys, and they had put up a teepee, did a demonstration on video of how to put up a teepee. And they start off, you know, singing their Comanche hymns. They talk about how they go to that, down in Norman, the language, they have a language competition every year. Yeah, a language fair, language competition every year. And how they go down there, they say, we go down there and our intent is to win. And that's all we have on our mind. And so it was just really inspirational, the things that they've done. And I was just, you know, all I was thinking, man, I really want that for our kids here. We don't do nothing for our youth. You know, we need to start something like that. And they have, you know, they're just going with it. They're going, it's going big time. And I was really impressed with it. The way that they see the problem and they're addressing it, you know, so I really enjoyed their presentation that they gave. And then the other one, the last day, they had a three-person panel from three different tribes, and they were talking about all the different ways that they have weight loss contests and how they encourage their employees and how they set up programs and how it works for them and things like that for three different tribes. And I was real impressed. There was one of them that was presenting. They were talking about how, what tribe was that, Donna? They did that 1% sales tax. They got their county commission to give 1% sales tax.
Osage.
To their organization. And
Bird Creek.
Yeah, the Bird Farms. Creek. Because it was a part, it was in their community. And I was just like, wow, that's, you know, that county would give that up. They would actually give 1%. Their sales tax to that organization because they know that it's within that county. It's something that they're going to benefit from to not only the tribal members. And I was really impressed with them on how they've, you know, they're really got a good, with the whole, they got a good relationship with the whole, with the city, with the county, you know, with their whole community. And it was real impressive on the lady giving the presentation on what they were doing over there. But I enjoyed the seventh generation. And then of course there was Miss Feathers, her name Carla? Carly, yeah. Carly, she's Pawnee too, and she was a big part of that organization, helping set that up and everything like that. So Pawnees were well represented over there, and I enjoyed the presentations. And I, you know, they had some really good presentations on like self-governance and things like that. But oh my gosh, they were so government employee. They're just, it was just so hard to concentrate because they were just like, you know, their voices just put you to sleep. So it's just like, oh my gosh, you know. I said, man, the government needs to invest in some training for those speakers so they could kind of, you know, talk and wake you up or something. But they were just, I said, I know this is good information. It took everything I had to try to pay attention. But anyway, all in all, I was, I enjoyed it. It was something new for me. It wasn't what I expected. You know, seventh generation, I thought it was going to be more kind of like toward youth or something, but it was a good conference, and I enjoyed it. So that's the only, it's only travel. I didn't have no committees that I met with, so that's my report. Any questions?
Okay. If not, then we'll move on to Sammy.
Thank you. To begin with, I would just personally like to thank each of my associate council members for your support over the last few weeks. We've had a tough time, and it's never easy. So I want to thank you for that, and the members of our audience that are here, I thank you for coming in this morning, and also thank you for your love and support that you bestowed upon my family over this difficult time for us. One of the meetings that I, one of the commissions that I chair is the Land Use Committee, and unfortunately I was unable to attend, and I really want to thank everybody for stepping up and moving forward with that meeting. And that would be Andrew, Bamey, Leanna, Rhonda, Deidre, and Daryl. Deidre was kind enough to send me some notes, so I'm just going to kind of paraphrase what went on. I had invited the BIA and Jeremy Love Camp, and who is the acting BIA superintendent, and Tara Littlecook, who is the BIA Realty Officer, attended that meeting, and I'm really glad that we have a place at the table for them. They discussed the process for the land buyback, and we already know that the BIA is not involved in that. That's all part of the DOI, Department of Interior, and also the Bureau of Land Management, so that was pretty clear for us to begin with. What we really wanted to talk to them was about fee to trust. And they delivered a package to us, and they referenced several pages in that packet to where we can go and assess and decide how we want to roll with that. So that process was discussed, and the takeaway from it was there's two additional issues that were brought by the BIA to us. Number one was the agricultural lease they provided notice to us in January of an auction in May. And we need to let the BIA know if we don't want to lease the land or if we have any other changes. Has anybody heard about that? Yeah, it's an agricultural lease. It's on here? Okay, great. And then the TDC is trying to put land into trust. And there's a company out of D.C., and she said EMP? They need permission from the Pawnee Business Council to conduct the NEPA and the SHIPO consultation for the tribe. This is why the government puts land into trust, and their request was dated 3/22/16, so I guess you can allude more to that, Roger. I don't know, but I clearly thank you all for stepping up and moving forward with our meetings, and I'll schedule something further down, you know, within the next 2 weeks to continue. That's all I have. All right. Any questions? Thank you.
Hey, if not, thank you, Sammy, and we'll move on to Adrian.
Noah, everyone. See everybody here today. Myself, I attended the April 7th budget meeting that Treasurer Thompson reported on, and I went down to the Indian Sports Commission Summit that was held in Oklahoma City that Donna had talked about, and I want to thank Donna and Bruce for both attending. You know, myself, it's been something I've been trying to get. I know council supports it. It's just that, you know, I've been trying to get, try to go to some events and everything. I was really pleased. There was a lot of information that was talked about there. It's an ever-changing sport, I guess you could say. One of the interesting things that I had found out while I was down there is that, you know, we're trying to get this recognition from the Association of Boxing Commissions. So what that talks about is that at some point when we want to have fights out here, and this is boxing, we have to be recognized by the Association of Boxing Commission, and that's a worldwide organization. That's federally regulated, and it's something that's pretty well mandatory. And also with that is MMA. MMA, mixed martial arts. For people, you know, that maybe might not know what that is, it's like the UFC. They have a lot of events around here in Oklahoma. That is not yet federally regulated, but there's regulations that's out there. And one of the big numbers that's in my eyes that a lot of people didn't know, that I didn't know until I got into this, was that 80% of combat sports, that's MMA and boxing, are held on tribal lands. And the other, I think it's 15% is in Las Vegas, and the rest is like California, maybe Madison Square Garden, you know, things like that. But almost all of these events are on tribal land. So one of the things that has come about since last year is that, you know, these this organization, this ABC, has federal, they have regulations for MMA. Like I said, it's not a federal mandated rules and stuff yet, but they've just kind of, the tribes have actually jumped on this and have developed their own regulations. And what's happening is that the sports commissions that tribes have, they are was wanting to establish their own I guess you say their own organization. And the people that were in charge of that ABC commission, the past couple of years, had a good working relationship with these tribes and told them that it wasn't in the best interest that they develop their own organization. And so these tribes were kind of felt slighted, I guess you could say, that they weren't allowed to have the, or they wasn't encouraged to have their own organization. Being that the fact that, you know, 80% of all combat sports events are held on tribal lands. Well, in the meantime, as of last year, we went to San Diego. the ABC, they had new officers selected. And the new officers that were selected, you know, still in full support of the tribes and what they're doing, but the old officers, they were upset because they didn't get reelected. And so since they didn't get reelected, they wanted to start their own organization. So the tribes were pretty upset about that, saying, you know, you told us we couldn't start our own organization, but yet now that you didn't get reelected, you're trying to start your own organization, you want us to go with you. So the tribes have started to form their own organization. We have regulations that even in our regulations that we have here that's been done by our sports commission are more regulated than the state of Oklahoma and a lot of these other states. They haven't caught up with the program yet, really. And so that's something that fares really, really good for tribes. And so the Indian Sports Commission Summit that was held in Oklahoma City was held by the Mille Lacs Band, and they had really encouraged other tribes. They have big sponsors with the Cherokee, the Chickasaws, tribes from California. So there's a lot of support there. And we was recognized by them and was given a plaque by the commission for the involvement and for the progression of the sports commission. And they were thankful for the Pawnee Nation. And so it was something that was very, very good to see and hear. And also, too, earlier this week, I attended the 7th Generation Conference in Tulsa. And earlier, several months back, you know, Donna had talked about it when we first got the email on it. She said that it was a good conference, so I was interested in going. And I want to thank you for that, Donna, because it really was. I didn't know what to expect, and to hear these sessions that they had, I attended probably kind of pretty much the same ones that they did. I Am Indian breakout session, the agricultural session. There was another one there that can't think of it right now, but they had some good speakers. I was very, very well. I don't know how to say. I guess excited to hear Walter Echohawk talk. You know, we have the luxury of getting to hear him a lot here at the tribe, you know, and hearing him speak. But what he spoke about that day was it was really something. It really, I guess you say, kind of hit home to a lot of tribes of how we got to the state that we are in today with our health. And to hear the information that he talked about, you know, concerning our tribe, the Pawnees, it really kind of brought a little different perspective, you know, of how I think about things and stuff. And so it was really something to see, something to hear, and I really enjoyed that conference. And, you know, makes me think about, you know, a lot of different stuff that our tribe here that we can do that I know that we've talked about in the past that hasn't really materialized, that maybe we need to get the ball rolling, you know, on this some more. So that's about all I have. If there's any questions, I'll try my best to answer.
All right. Well, thank you.
Yep.
Okay. Oh, okay.
So when are we going to get the ball rolling and getting an event?
I'm actually working on that right now. I've contacted, been in contact with Dale Apollo Cook out of Tulsa. He's been doing events with Buffalo Run and Creek Nation at the River Spirit. He was one of the first ones that I talked to about 12 years ago about having an event here. So he's very, very well on board. And I also started talking to this other woman. Her name is Dorothy Foss, I believe. Might be Haas. I have to check my notes. And they are both working on some proposals right now to bring them to the tribe to see about how we can work out having our first event. I'm hoping, you know, this is my own personal deal. I'm hoping we can have one in June, but I know time's ticking away, and I want to make sure it's a good event. So, you know, I want to make sure we give ourselves enough time to you know, advertise and get things in order, you know, to be able to have a good show.
And then I'm just going to put it out there. So would the sports commission also be the people that facilitate like a basketball tournament, a baseball tournament, that type of stuff?
That was that's one of the things that I was hoping that they would do. I wanted them to be involved in any kind of sports things that's here. That's why I called them the sports commission. Mm-hmm. You know, because we I had talked to them before in another meeting that they had that I wanted them to also look at other things besides, you know, these combat sports. Also looking at having a basketball tournament here, like mm-hmm. a high school basketball mm-hmm. tournament, you know, small school invitational, something like that. Also looking at, you know, what's very popular that we had an opportunity to do here years ago was Indian horse racing. So, yeah, there's a lot of different things.
That'd be great. I know that in the early 80s when I lived here, Jarvis Leroy did a lot of basketball tournaments and such at the at the agency gym. And it'd really be good. I mean, it generates income, and it's awesome. So I'd like to see that happen. Good. Thanks, Adrian.
Also, too, at the sports commission there, I got to, I don't know, Bruce, if you got to meet him, that Andre and Tyrone Roberts. I know probably a lot of you guys maybe might not know, but Andre Roberts is a huge, huge Indian guy from, I think he was, Ojibwe, I guess, huh? I forgot already. But when UFC started, he was on there, and he has probably one of the best professional records in the UFC. He's like 14-2. Gosh, what is he, about 6'5", 300 pounds, and there's a game out there, UFC video game, and he's on there. I did not know that, so that's something, you know, and he's a really nice guy, and he was well received when he went to these different places, and he had a knee injury. He tore his ACL. He had surgery back then. He talked about, you know, it's not like it is today, and he never fully recovered from that. So, but he's a wrestling coach. He works there for a lot of the youth there at the at their tribe, at their gymnasium, and he has a younger brother who is going to try. He has a professional winning record in the UFC, and he's going to try again one more time. He had talked about how, you know, he had some problems with drugs and alcohol, and so how he has changed his life up. And so he is working with youth as well, and he is a referee. And also we got to meet one guy that's from Oklahoma. He lives down there around Tallahena area. His name is Rocky Demir. I think I'm saying his name right. He is also a person I'll be talking to about putting on events. He is a referee. He is the first Native American referee to actually be on national television at a huge event. It was a boxing fight in Washington, the state of Washington. And so he got to do a championship fight. So that was something that was encouraging. And that's one of the things that the Indian Sports Commission wants to do is they want to acknowledge our Indian people that are in these professions so that it'll give youth, you know, an opportunity to look at other things that they could do to encourage them to pursue and do things. So that's all. Yes.
And, of course, I've got to take an opportunity to promote my son, who is my favorite Pawnee boxer. He has an upcoming fight on May 21st. In Shawnee, and I can't wait to see him in the ring here when we get our setup.
Yes.
So I'm just very proud of him.
Well, and then that's one of the things too is that I want us to do, and then that's what I talked to some of these other sports commissions. Like Donna talked about how the Wichitas, you know, they bring their own tribal members in, you know, and they support them, and it builds a lot of community, you know. Pride, and so it's one of the things that I hope that we can do that as well. So That's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Adrian, we'll move back to Leanna.
Okay, I have a lot. I have a lot of things to tell you. I've been busy. I want to start with, in two minutes. Okay, let me back up. I'm not dressed as usual as I would be for a council meeting because this is the week of the young child. And today at 10 o'clock, the Learning Center will be hosting their annual celebration in the week of the young child. And then they have a balloon release after that in memory of my niece, Marissa Chapman. And so I would like to be excused to do this. And if you want, I can come back and give my report, or I can just go through it quick.
It's up to you. But you're released.
Okay, then I'll do that. And if you're interested, I can tell you land management, you talked about that. Proposal review, you'll be talking about that. I attended the Youth Movement Field Day at OSU. We have the college president, and I attended the Board of Trustees meeting. I attended the hockey in Tulsa, the Week of the Young Child tomorrow with more activities. I attended the leadership meeting of the service unit yesterday, and also that in conference preparing for the seventh generation indigenous health and well-being, a seventh generation perspective. If you want to hear more, I'll tell it later. Thank you.
All right. Well, tell those folks our thoughts and prayers are still with all the family, and it's a good thing they're doing today. I was going to add this on the Indigenous Athletic Commission summit that they had down in Oklahoma City. I attended that, and I want to say that I didn't know what to expect when I went to be a part of that, but that was really good, really good. And I know Adrian has been after council to attend something, you know, and to see what he's been attending and these things. And if we're gonna do this, and we are, and be a part of the entertainment and also the professionalism involved, and as far as the regulatory and all of that, it was really a lot of information, good information. It got me excited about the possibility of having events here, and when we get other facilities through TDC and all of the things that we can provide, not only to our nation, but to our community, Stillwater, you know, all of those. Angela's son, backing him as a Pawnee boy boxer, you know, and getting behind that, and I'd be in favor of the sports commission, you know, promoting him and sponsoring him, you know. I mean, we don't have these kind of athletes come through like that very often, and help him in, you know, his training efforts and things like that. We just need to get going on it and really have it a part of our community and utilize our facilities, utilize, you know, what we can and what we can do, and provide things for our community to come and see and be a part of. And so that was really good seeing that wrestler. He's a huge man, and we were able to. They said, "Hey, you got some videos, man?" He brought out some old VHSs and he threw them on, and we watched his wrestling matches. And I was sitting there, not as the president of Pawnee Nation. I was sitting there as a wrestling fan, it was fun. And these men were great athletes. Went through it, had tremendous fights, and fought against legends, you know, and won, so that was really, really something. And so I'm in full support of, and anxious to see that we get something going with the Athletic Commission here. One of the things I also failed to mention, I mentioned it at the last council meeting. I had attended a meeting with Ned Williams, and, you know, he had given an update as far as the state of the school system here and the monies that have been pulled by the state out of the fund here, out of our school fund, and the deficit that all of our schools, not only here, but all over the state of Oklahoma, all the teachers, all the administrative staff, bus drivers, sports programs, you know, all of these things that are vital for our kids and for our children as far as their education, as far as extracurricular, all of these things, as far as safety, you know, that are being cut. And the Pawnee Public Schools is one of them that is really suffering some cuts. You know, I heard that Ned Williams is going to teach a class next year because of the cuts, and possibly start coaching again because they just can't go out and pay another teacher to come in. And so, I believe that the schools has put out a information, I think, to the community. I don't know if it was in this chief's issue this week or not. I forgot to get a chief, but maybe. But he put out a state of where they are as far as the school system and things. And one of the things he put in there, because I had talked with him, and what Angela had said, we have given money, for our language program there and different other programs through the school system. And, my hope is that we can help them even more, somehow, maybe through this next school year with tutoring, something. This year we didn't have no tutoring at the school for anyone. There was no tutoring whatsoever. And really our all of our students, and especially our Indian students, have suffered because of that lack of tutoring. And so I would like us to really come together as the business council, as the nation, and really try to step forward and help our school systems. We also have students down there in Yale and I believe at Glencoe and things. And the other tribes are stepping up and helping where they at in their school system. And so Mr. Williams, I know that he had put something in that the Pawnee Nation is helping the school system, but he's using the monies that we've already helped them with as the basis. But I'm hopeful that we can do even more to help our school system. I didn't know if you saw that. The governor, she's found a way to put more money back into it, but did you hear what she's doing? She's borrowing money from next year. Just borrow money from next year to pay for this year. And so we're going to go into next year, and we're already going to be in already a deficit, big deficit, you know. And the state of Oklahoma, I realize that they're strapped for money. Strapped for money with the oil industry like it is, but it's really, really a serious issue, and if there's something we can do, that would be great. Just wanted to add those things, and any question on that? All right, well, let's move on, and we move to item number 8, which is the Pawnee Business Council travel request for approval. Any travel coming up? Yes, Cindy? Well, that was one I was bringing up. I was going to bring up. Okay. Yes.
Angela? I have one request. I'm requesting to attend the Tribal Self-Governance Annual Conference, and only requesting a portion of my expenses be paid. I will be attending the CSC consultation on Wednesday as well as bringing back any other information.
Okay. All right. Any other travel?
I'm requesting travel for this evening. There is a event going on in Ponca City. It's called Flowers on the Lake. It's a domestic violence presentation that's put on by the Kaw Nation. So okay. I'm requesting travel for that this evening.
All right. Any other travel? And
or request some travel for sovereignty symposium. Signed up to go to that.
Oh, that one. That one's a committee, so you would go to that. Yeah, Daryl's going to represent myself as the leader of the nation at our Standing Bear Shalako meeting. It's the tribal leaders meeting. So that's next week, right?
Yes.
Okay, so he'll be going to that. What we're also needing the okay for is the Sovereignty Symposium that's coming up, and the council has already indicated which ones are going and which ones aren't, so we need approval for that. Next week, I already have approval to go to the health conference there in Shawnee, but they're also having a United Nations, Tribal Nations Leaders Summit there in Shawnee on that Friday. They're sponsored by the Citizen Potawatomis, and so asking permission to attend that also on behalf of the nation. Any other travel? All right, if not, entertain a motion to accept the travel and vote on it.
Make that motion.
Motion's made, a second.
I'll second.
We have a second. All those in favor say yes.
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 Any opposed? No. Okay, all the travel is approved. I forgot to mention this, and I aired in the reports is we had a hockey game last Saturday that the Pawnee Nation was a part of, sponsored by the TDC. And I tell you what, you want to meet Pawnees you haven't seen and maybe never seen. You've never seen them. Don't know who they are. You know, this event there in Tulsa brings them out. I met all kinds of Pawnees and from different families who went there and you know, they all enjoyed it, brought their families and things, and you know, there was whole sections of Pawnees there. How many of you attended? Any of you attend? Yeah, it was good. It's good, and we make it a community event, you know, and try anyone from the community, because they give us those tickets and things, and so just a lot of Pawnee citizens, Pawnee Nation citizens, and folks from Pawnee who go over there and enjoy a game, and it's always a lot of fun. You know, we had a funeral that Saturday, and so my family did the feast on that, So I attended most of the game, but I was tired. I was really tired, and I left early because I was just wore out. But wanted to go, and Leanne and I we dropped the puck. You know, you guys need to attend and be puck droppers. get out there on the ice and drop that puck. But you know, just a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun, and it's a way to bring our people together and things, and they all indicated that they enjoyed it. You know, we have tribal dancing there, and for all those who come, those people really enjoy. Those have a big crowd around them watching the Indians dance, and so it's always a good thing. So always appreciate that, Roger. Appreciate the efforts that you make. You know, the advertisement. You got to advertise. In order to make money, you got to spend money, and so it's a good thing. So appreciate that. All right, just wanted to say that. So at this time, let's move on to the TDC report. All right, that was a good intro for you, wasn't it?
Well, good morning, Council and guests.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Beautiful morning outside. Sammy, to go a little bit in depth in what you were talking about, you know, we're in the process of getting the 20 acres in trust to the north of Stonewolf. And part of that, and I'm reading from an email trying to explain some of this, is under Section 106 of the National Historic Preservation Act, we have to get concurrence with the State Historic Preservation Office that the proposed project will not have an adverse effect on historic resources. And so that's what that was pertaining to. And what this typically consists of is a letter that describes a project with maps and descriptions of what's going on, and a request that the Historic Society concurs with the project and the findings. What has happened is the environmental company has reached out to the local Pawnee BIA office, and they indicated, like Jeremy was saying, that it needed a response from the Pawnee Nation to allow the environmental company to go ahead and do that. And they're putting together the letter and stuff to do that. What I don't know, and what I've gone back and asked, is what kind of response are they talking about? Is it a is it a motion from the council? I don't know the answer to that yet. So
just keep us informed.
I will
help you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
fairly short report this morning. Adrian, I'd be anxious to visit with you more. Sounds like we're getting close to where we can really start looking at an event and everything being ready and in line to have an event. So anxious for that and anxious to speak with you on that. The closing date for the loan with BOK is next Friday, the 22nd, which is closing of the note for the monies for the expansion at Stonewall. So we're anxiously awaiting next Friday to get that done. The next TDC board meeting is this coming Tuesday night, and we will have a couple of things that we have to finish up as far as agreements and stuff in order to be able to close next Friday. With that, as far as kind of a timetable that you can be aware of, after the closing, we're probably looking at 45 to 60 days before groundbreaking. There's a couple of things that will have to be done in order for the groundbreaking to happen. Number one, the finalizations of the design and all the construction documents, and then also the approval process that goes through the BIA. That process can take up to 60 days. We've already started the process, so I think we have a head start on that. So I'm hoping that it's going to be closer to the 45 versus the 60 days for the groundbreaking. Kudix, TDC's ownership. Did I say that correct, Adrian?
Kudix.
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 Kudix. I'll get my tongue rolling right.
You'll get it.
Is going to be a part of that construction project. Their role is 30%. It's a 70-30 percent split on the project. We are excited about that percent. A big part of that, what dictated that percent of our involvement in that, was the bonding and being able to get the necessary bonding to do the project. Currently, we have about $3 million in bonding, and so 30% of the project would be a little over $2 million of that, so we didn't want to go any more than that because we want to be able to be picking up other jobs in additional to that while this project is going on. So we still have $1 million in bonding capability so that we can go out looking for additional work up to $1 million. We have been working at Pawnee Star Design as far as getting the retail side ready to open up. If you've driven by, you've seen at the front of the building, the concrete has been poured. Some of the lowered ceiling inside the retail area, had to have some work, some counters built, so on and so forth. That has all been done, and we now are starting to look at putting together the inventory for that. So I, for the retail site. So we're anticipating in the next 2 weeks, we will be opening up the retail side of the screen printing. As I indicated earlier, the next TDC board meeting is next Tuesday night, which is the 19th, I believe. That is my report. Are there any questions?
I have one. So when is the branding going to happen with our gas stations and such?
We are working on that. There's a lot of variables involved in that. We are under some contracts with Phillips 66 and such that we mm-hmm. have to look at and analyze. I have meetings next week actually on that, uh-huh. whether we stay branded with Phillips 66, the cost of getting out of those contracts,
sure.
those type of things.
Sure.
But we are working on it.
Uh-huh. And then I saw you out to the plaza. I think it was the plaza. I did see you at mm-hmm. the plaza the other day. And tell me that driveway is going to get fixed, too, when we get this.
Yeah, that's part
thank
of.
Thank you. My alignment's been completely thrown out.
Yeah. No, you're talking about the south entry.
Uh-huh.
And, yes, that's part of the scope of work
okay,
on
great.
The expansion.
Good.
As well as trying to there is a tremendous amount of groundwater that flows down that hillside. Mm-hmm. And so doing some French drains and those type of mm-hmm. things to try to prohibit that groundwater from coming into the front of the store and casino there mm-hmm. will also be addressed.
Sure. Thanks a bunch.
I have a few questions. Where are we ever going to buy that property instead of lease it? Is there any discussions on buying the property?
Are you talking about where Stonewolf is at?
Yes.
We've discussed that here, matter of fact.
Uh-huh.
It requires a letter from council to instigate that to the BIA.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we need to have that discussion. And well, make that determination.
It was already discussed, and wasn't you supposed to write a letter, or was that Misty when she was in? There was a letter that was supposed to be written to the BIA to discuss about the start of the purchasing of that land.
There, that's what she initiated when she was president. We have a document with the heirs on it, and so we have that, and from that we need to go from there, and
let's do it.
All yes.
Right. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
All right.
Also, with that, if I could add something to that, I don't understand all of how the land purchasing. Works, but I think there is the possibility of, you know, we purchased the 20 acres of land to the north of Stonewolf. Well, that was off of an 80 acre parcel. I think the remaining 60 acres is a possibility for to be purchased, and I think that's something we need to be looking at and trying to come up with a plan.
I would like to think that the plan would incorporate all of that. I would like to see us or the TDC, you know, to purchase all the land that's around that area mm-hmm. that we can. I know we probably don't have the money to do all that at this point, but it's in that scope of work is, you know, your strategic planning.
Well, and what I'm hoping is through the land buyback that has been talked about is if somehow that could be used in that 60 acres, and I don't understand how all of that works.
Do you know how many heirs come into that by chance?
On the 60 acres, there's one person.
Oh, there's only one.
Now that's different than what we're talking about on the Stonewolf property. Mm-hmm. But
and Stonewolf, any swag on how many heirs come into that?
there, I believe there's been a request from the, if this is an indication, mm-hmm. there's, you know, we're sending out all the documents and everything to the heirs mm-hmm. through the BIA because they're the caretaker of the lease. Mm-hmm. They have requested 65 copies. So if that's an indication, you know, I don't know the exact number, but okay. I know they've requested 65 copies.
Okay. That's something to work on. Thank you.
That land that you was talking about north there that had one heir, that is non-tribal land. So I don't know if the land buyback program will work on that, but as far as the one with the where we have the lease with, you know, there's a possibility with that.
My question on that, though, was that at one time. And so if it was at one time trust land, then I think it falls under that program.
No, is that wrong?
No, yeah, it is.
Okay.
It what the program is about is taking land that is so fractionated by ownership.
Okay.
That
okay.
they buy it back and give it back to the tribe and then take care of.
I understand.
Yeah. So that one would just be just a complete buy, just outright buy, and then into trust.
Okay.
Into trust.
My other question is, I know this is probably late coming, but I just have to ask it. I see all these other casinos building, adding on to their current facilities, just putting up a metal fab building that not costing them $7.5 million, you know, or whatever, millions of dollars. So, I mean, has that option been looked at? What did TDC look at?
I mean,
those types
that's
of options?
Yeah, that's basically what's going on. I mean, of course, then it is cosmetics of that is decorated up.
So it's not brick and mortar we're doing.
No,
it is a metal fab. But
yes,
we're just adding
metal. Vehicles. Yes.
Okay, so that's what's driving up the cost.
It's. There's a lot of things that drive up the cost. That driveway that we're talking about, you know, that, you know, there's a bunch of pieces to that, but I can promise you we are being very diligent in making sure we're doing this as cheap as possible. Why would we not want to do that?
I was
so,
just wondering because
yeah.
when I look at what we have out there now compared to what I'm seeing in other places,
I understand. But if you look like at Paradise and what they're doing, that's more than a metal building right now. I mean, they are really adding on to the facility there and really stepping up because before it was basically cement block. Mm-hmm. And while that may still be the structure, now there's cosmetics being done that is really they're really stepping up their game. But I think they've had to because of the competition, especially to the north with the Osage Casino.
Yes, okay. Ag plan.
Yes, I was scheduled to go to Arkansas. I forget the date now. They called the day before and had to cancel. And so I'm hoping to get there in May.
And you said the opening date for the Pawnee Star design is when?
I didn't say a specific date.
Oh, okay.
I said that we're trying to get open in the next 2 weeks, and then we're going to have a grand opening sometime in May.
So you're maybe willing to take, I mean, when are you going to be able to start taking orders?
We can take orders now. We've been doing orders.
Okay, and who do I contact?
Jordan Claiborne.
Okay. And is that at CDC?
No, it's at the office, or at
can
the
you give me their number?
Store. I don't have it,
when you get a
but
chance.
I will get it to you. Yes.
All right. Thank you.
I just going back to the naming of the stores. Mm-hmm. What does Phillip 66 got to do with naming our stores?
It has to do with the branding, and. So when she asked that question, I'm talking about four stores, you know, four convenience stores that we're looking at. And part of the branding is color and those type of things. And so Phillip 66 is red, for example. Do we? I mean, there's a lot of things. It doesn't have to do with the naming of Snack and Pack, but it does have to do with the overall branding. And because part of that is who you go with as far as a brand, if you go with a brand as a gasoline and all that, it dictates some of the things you do in the branding, not the name.
Okay, well, I was just wondering about just the name. I mean, like, you already have the T-shirt shop name. That's why I was just, like, wondering about, you know, because there's no indication anywhere that those facilities belong to the Pawnee Nation at all.
Yeah.
You know, and we've had them for
quite a while now. I answered that last council meeting, or last time I was here, that's we plan on having that done this summer. So.
All right.
I have a little bit. I just want most of the comments, I guess. You know, I'm excited about this closing date that's coming up, and I'm glad that you're letting us know about the 45 to 60 day groundbreaking, because if you all remember, we was going to do groundbreaking, I believe, last May.
Yeah.
And I hate when the nation does that. You know, they break ground and then nothing happens for a year or so. You know, so I'm glad that, you know, you're keeping on top of that, and you know, we'll have more closer to the actual groundbreaking than times past. And I'm also excited that this construction company, Hooters Construction, is having a part of that casino build, 30%. You know, that adds a lot to the company itself, to market it out to other tribes and their other construction plans that they have as well, to show that, you know, they're capable of doing that. You know, we was talking about the upgrades that the Otos were having, you know, and up there, and I was talking to some people up there that I know, Otos, and you were talking about the Osages, but they're also worried about the tribe. They've been hearing for a while that we were going to upgrade, so yeah. They're trying to, you know, get things built up there, mm-hmm. as soon as they can to compete, so, because mm-hmm. They're a little more out there than, you know, than we are, but like they've always said, you know, you build stuff, the people will come to them, you know. I have one question, though, is that the other day I was out there at the Travel Plaza, and they had a spill out there. A spill or something? I saw that they had environmental out there and everything on one of the pumps. What was happening?
Yeah, they had a pump that was leaking. Okay. And so then Domino, who we used for repairs and stuff, came in, fixed the leak, and then everything you saw out there was just assessing the leak and what went on with it, you know, what damage there was, if any, and all of that.
So everything's all on the up and up now?
Everything's on the up and up. We're going to do some further testing to make sure there wasn't any. We're going to have some boring done to make sure there wasn't any mm-hmm. issues. Mm-hmm. Just being on the cautionary side. So, and that's actually going to happen Monday. So
you'll keep us abreast of that outcome.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and Roger, on the upside, just a comment from me is I'm really excited for this build out to the Wolf. I think we need to have a class act out there for all the people heading down the 412 and coming up north on the 18. So I'm really excited for it. And I'm supportive of making it something that's going to be, we can all be proud of.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I see the plastic on the walls. I'm like, oh, my God, I hate that. But then I understand. I get it. So hopefully we're going to get all that fixed up.
It is exciting. And I get goosebumps because I am excited. And you heard me honking as I left the last time because, you know, it's an exciting time.
It is.
And there's been a lot of hard work by a lot of people.
Yes.
And a lot of dreams. Mm-hmm. And so it's nearing.
Yeah,
so.
It'll be wonderful. Thank you.
To add to that, too, you know, talking to a lot of the people at the Sports Commission about our expansion and everything, and talking to those two promoters, their mouths are watering because they're talking about 412 and how close they are to Stillwater and about getting people to come out there. They said it's a no-brainer. And also, too, you know, here's another question I was going to ask earlier that I forgot about was, and I know it's down the road you know, a couple of years from now. But, you know, you're talking about this hotel that we want to try to do. Are you going to have meeting rooms and stuff there,
yes,
too, to try to
conference
have, like, conferences?
Rooms. Okay. Yes.
Because sports commission, this Indian Sports Commission, they'd like to have one here at our facility.
You know, and let me say this on that. You know, we've talked about how the numbers will be analyzed at 6 months and looked at and all of those things. But let me also say this on that. We are continuing to look for other means, too. Okay? So, in other words, if we find a lender that's willing to go more than what we have now to where we can refinance, we will speed this process up. We talked to somebody this past week, even. We'll continue with what we have, but that doesn't keep us from looking and refinancing if we can find somebody where we can get this done faster. So that is, we're not just settling for what's going on. So.
Okay, well, that's good. That's good to hear.
All right. Well, thank you, Roger.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
That. And all right, we're closing. That's good. Good. Good work. Next is number 10 is the Pawnee Nation College President Report.
You know, Bruce, I want to say something real quick.
Yeah.
I wanted to say it earlier. You know, we was talking about the local school system, you know, and how they're with the budget cuts and stuff, you know. You know, I have been reading, you know, the news. Hold on here. And I know that the tribes, a lot of our gaming compacts, we pay a lot of money to the state. And a lot of that is supposed to be done for education. I saw a report last year, this year, talking about how much the tribes have paid the state over the past 10 years, and it was in the billions. Looking at this physical report for 2014, and it went off here. Oh, in 2014, the tribes have paid the state $122 million. That's in 1 year. And it shows other years and stuff. Now, this is 2014. I don't know what last year's was. They might not be out yet or whatever. But when are the tribes going to force the state to say, hey, what are you doing with this money? Because now we're digging into our more money to help support our local schools when we're already doing that. You know, and I know, to me, what it really boils down to is this Mary Fallon and all of them putting money in their pockets and all those other things. But that's what his intention's for. They told the state, they told the people that when we do this lottery and when these tribes have these gaming facilities, this money is for education. And we're still 47th out of 50 states in education. You know, so I, you know, it really bothers me. And I, you know, I know we have that, I can't even think of it right now, but I know we have these organizations and stuff, NCAI, maybe might be one of them, I don't know. But when is the state and the tribes going to say, develop a letter and say, hey, you know, Governor Fallon, what are you guys doing with our money that we're giving to the state?
Marshall?
You know, in years past, I asked Governor Fallon point blank, you know, where's the money gone from the lottery
for education? And she couldn't answer me. She told me that she would get back to me, get a letter. I never received that letter. And after that, there was a representative up at the City Hall, and they asked me to come up, and I asked that representative where the money was from the lottery for education. I said, almost every Indian tribe around gives money to the local school board because they don't have the money. And I said, even the Pawnee Nation kicks into our local school board because they don't have the money And we don't have the money at the school board up here even for tutors, and we've kicked in. And I never received any answer back. So I encourage you all to keep after that, keep asking, because that money isn't being accounted for. And there's been millions and millions and billions paid in through the lottery and through Indian nations that's not accounted for. And we shouldn't be having these cuts in our school systems, because our kids are getting cheated. That's plain and simple. Keep asking, because the governor can't answer, and they need to be answered.
And just to add to that as well, is what we can do as citizens of Oklahoma is to contact our state legislatures and ask them that same question. Where's the accountability in those education dollars? Where's it going? Because everybody knows gaming brings in money. And where's it going? And and she has not been accountable to that. And not any even prior ones, but even since she's been in office, it's declined. And these are our kids that are being educated, and they're not throwing money behind it.
Well, the short answer is this, and it was told to us at a meeting, leaders meeting, that the money that has been designated from Indian gaming that's supposed to go to education, it does, all of it. Because it's mandated. And so all that money that we put in for our Indian gaming does go to education, but what she has done is she's pulled the base money that used to be there. What our intention was that this set amount of money that was for education through taxes and things was that the Indian gaming money was supposed to be added to it. And so you would have more. Well, what happened was that the Indian gaming money that was added to it, it's still there. But what she did is she took from the base, and she pulled money from the base.
Cheap.
And so it's actually less. Overall, it's less. Even though we've put in a lot more, it's less. And it was done through all the ways that they have, and when things were good, you know, oil was good and everything was good, nobody complains. You know, I mean, there has been complaints from, you know, the teachers as far as their salaries and lowest paid and all of that. But man, you talk about being hit. Now it's all being revealed. It's being revealed. And so the tribal nations, Indian gaming has done their share. What she's done is pulled it from the other things. Yes, Roger.
Yeah.